الحمد لله، الحمد لله خالق الوجود من العدم، وجاعل النور من الظلم، ومخرج الصبر من الألم، وملقي التوبة على الندم. فنشكره على المصائب كما نشكره على النعم، ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم ذي الشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبيين والخاتم، سيد ولد آدم الذي بشر به عيسى بن مريم ودعا لبعثته إبراهيم عليه السلام حين كان يرفع قواعد بيت الله المحرم، فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم الذين بارك الله بهم كافة الناس العرب منهم والعجم. فالحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل، وكبره تكبيرا. والحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا. والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ به من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله، أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله، وكفى بالله شهيدا. فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. ثم أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. يقول سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: إن قارون كان من قوم موسى فبغى عليهم، وآتيناه من الكنوز ما إن مفاتحه لتنوء بالعصبة أولي القوة إذ قال له قومه لا تفرح إن الله لا يحب الفريحين، وابتغ فيما آتاك الله الدار الآخرة ولا تنس نصيبك من الدنيا وأحسن كما أحسن الله إليك ولا تبغ الفساد في الأرض إن الله لا يحب المفسدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. واللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله، واللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، آمين يا رب العالمين. In today's khutbah, inshallah ta'ala, I'll share with you some thoughts, some reflections from a couple of ayat that belong to Surah Al-Qasas. The majority of Surah Al-Qasas, Allah talks about the story of Musa alayhi salam. And towards the last end of Surah Al-Qasas, after a brief bit of advice, like a maw'idha Allah gives to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam about how to carry the message of Islam to the Quraysh and to the people of the book, then towards the end of the surah, Allah azza wa jal tells us about another character from the Israelites, almost in many ways the opposite of Musa alayhi salam, but still belonging to the Israelites. It is Qarun. And it's remarkable, just as part of the union of the surah and the cohesion of the surah, that what is many of the characteristics described of Musa alayhi salam in the beginning, a lot of those characteristics, exactly the opposite of them, are described with Qarun at the end of the surah. So there's this contrast that is being portrayed in the surah. Anyway, so Allah tells us a few things about Qarun, and I think some of them are create a lot of confusion for people if they don't pay attention to what Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, unfortunately, even in some translations, because translations, you have to understand, they have a complication to them. A translator has an opportunity to say what Allah says in one line. Allah says an ayah, and the translator tries to communicate what Allah says in just one sentence, which is pretty much impossible. So there's always going to be something missing. And a lot of times what is missing can create confusion. So as you will see, inshallah, at least the first lesson that I want to draw and share with you is something that can cause a lot of people confusion. So let me briefly translate first, and then inshallah ta'ala, we'll go through some explanation. Inna qaruna kana min qawmi Musa. Qarun, no doubt, used to belong to the nation of Musa alayhi salam. Fabagha alayhim, then he was a rebel against them. And I'll comment as we go. He rebelled against them, or he was a traitor towards them. You could translate it like that. Abaghi can also be a traitor. Why is he being called a traitor? You see, Fir'aun is in charge, and the Israelites, the Banu Israel, they are slaves. They are being held in a ghetto population, and they're being controlled, and they're being beaten, and they're being abused for labor, and they're being horribly mistreated. When you treat people like this for a long period of time, there's a danger that they might rebel, that they might have an uprising, you know? And this is something that's not very hard for us to imagine nowadays, because these sorts of things are happening in world politics all the time. When people are under oppression for a long time, they have their own version of an uprising. Now, Fir'aun was afraid that there might be an uprising. And we learn this actually in Surah Al-Qasas itself. وَنُرِيَ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا مِنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَحْذَرُونَ. They were actually afraid themselves that there might be an uprising. So one of the ways that Fir'aun wanted to control the people is he had what you can call in easy language sellouts. He had certain people from Banu Israel that he paid good money, and they would keep an eye on the Israelites and what they're talking about, or if anybody's getting out of line, so he could report back. And in order to be this kind of a sellout, or to be able to spy on his own community, he made a lot of money as a result. So the first thing we're learning about Qarun is that yes, he is from the nation of Musa, but yet his loyalties are not with them, he's a traitor against them. And as a result, he makes a lot of money, and Allah allows him to make that money. So Allah says actually, وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْكُنُوزِ. We in fact granted him all kinds of treasures. What Allah is saying here is that even though he's making his money from Fir'aun, who's allowing that to happen? Allah Azza wa Jal is. Allah is not making him bankrupt. Allah is not crushing him or destroying him. Later on we'll see his house actually, and he himself got sunk into the earth. But that's later on, that's not for this khutbah. So now he has this loads of wealth. مَا إِنَّ مَفَاتِحَهُ لَتَنُؤُ بِالْعُصْبَةِ أُولِي الْقُوَّةِ. The grammarians, the nahwiyun, and the Mufassirun that talk about the language of the Qur'an, they have a long discussion about this bit of an ayah. I won't give you that in this khutbah, but I'll give you a summary. And the summary is the way Allah describes this treasure is very unusual. Instead of allati, there's a ma here. Instead of the inna, it's not even normally used here. To suggest this is an unusually large volume of treasure that this guy has. And then ma inna mafatihahu. Mafatih can be translated as keys. So you can imagine this guy has vaults. Back in the day, you didn't have banks, but you had vaults of your own. Your own, we have like little security deposit boxes, but these are actual massive vaults that each person has, they own themselves. So Allah is talking about the keys of those vaults. Now imagine the olden days, they didn't have like keys like we have now, they had large logs of wood that you put on top, on the latch, and you have to have a few men come and pick it up and take it off, so you can open the vault. So Allah says, مَا إِنَّ مَفَاتِحَهُ لَتَنُؤُ بِالْعُصْبَةِ أُولِي الْقُوَّةِ. That even the keys that he had, or these opening latches that he had, it would take a bunch of strong men to grab it, and even they would get exhausted after even trying to open it once. Meaning extremely secure, and if the lock is that big, and if the vault is that big, then what is inside, you can even imagine. The other issue here, the other thing is, mafatih can be used as a dharf. And what that would mean is actually, just imagine this giant gate, like if you see like old school banks, they have the giant spindle thing, and you have to really pull it open to open the door. So the door to his vaults would actually be so huge that it would take a few guys to even pull it open so he could access his vaults. And he doesn't have one, he has a number of those. He has a number, it's not maftah or miftah, it's mafatih, it's the plural. Which means he has a number of these vaults all over. So he's got massive, massive security. By the way, because he needs a few men like this, these are in public places. I mean, you don't have secure old places. This is in public, like his vaults are out in the public. So when he has his security guards come and open the vault, the rest of the community can see. And the rest of the community is Banu Israel. He lives among them. But he's the only billionaire among a bunch of bankrupt people. Everybody else is living like slaves. And this guy is living like a billionaire. And he's got his nice ride, he's got his nice house, and he's got these vaults everywhere that nobody can open. And as he's opening it, now there's this scene that is being painted. إِذْ, the word إِذْ, this dharfiyah here, tells us everything. إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ قَوْمُهُ لَا تَفْرَحْ. At the time when his nation said to him, don't be happy. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْفَرِحِينَ. I'll give you a rough translation first. Allah doesn't love those who are overly happy. Now somebody might read that last part of the ayah and say, see, Allah doesn't like people who get too happy. And somebody, you're sitting in a party somewhere, somebody's smiling. Eh, لَا تَفْرَحْ. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْفَرِحِينَ. Don't be happy, Allah doesn't love people who get too happy. No, no, no. That's not what this ayah means. This is all one ayah. You see, Allah actually gave us a principle in the Quran. He says, لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. You have to reflect deeply into his ayat. Every ayah is one unit, is one lesson. You cannot separate one part of it from another part of it. It's one discussion. Allah didn't even separate the ayah yet. And the word idh suggests that at the time when the security guards are opening his gate and they're getting exhausted, and you know, as it opens little by little, he sees his coins inside and all this stuff, and his face lights up, and people see the look on his face when he's looking at his money, and that's when they say to him, listen, man, don't be happy like that. Allah doesn't like this kind of happiness. Allah doesn't like people who get happy over this reason. And what are you happy about? What does Allah describe? One, he has money, and two, the way he made his money. The way he made his money is by selling his people out. You know, by being a traitor to his own people. What reason do you have to be happy? Now before we go any further, just about this ayah I wanted to share with you. Allah Azza wa Jal gives everybody wealth. People who make money through halal means Allah gives them. People who make money through haram means Allah gives them too. People who make their money by causing other people harm, Allah gives them too. As a matter of fact, even a robber can become wealthy by robbing someone. You know, banks are some of the wealthiest institutions after robbing the poor. That's a reality of the world today, you know. So you have people that can have enormous amounts of wealth after, you know, messing people over. And they're obviously very happy when they see their wealth, when they go on their expensive vacations and their private jets and all of this other stuff. But I'm not talking about billionaires today. Let's just at least talk about ourselves. Allah gives you and me wealth also. Some little, some more. And whatever He gives us, it can become a result of you constantly thinking about your money. There are two problems here. One, the way you make the money. And two, the fact that you have money makes you really happy. You keep checking the online app and logging back into your online banking and looking at it and smiling. You know, you keep doing that. Or you keep looking at the car that you're about to buy. You keep looking at its picture over and over again. You know? Or they just announced iPhone 6 is coming out, so there's a smile on your face the moment you saw the update. There's this look on your face. In other words, it's material things that make you really happy. Just the next material acquisition as a result of your money, it just makes you really, really happy. This is the problem. This is the advice that was so valuable that his community gave him, but Allah sees so much value in that advice, He made it part of His Quran. He made it timeless advice. You should not be so hung up on your wealth and the things you can get with your wealth that you're constantly overly excited about the next product, about the next vacation, about the next clothes, about the next house, you know. And if this thing is the only thing that's bringing a smile to your face, then لا تفرح إن الله لا يحب الفرحين. The question then is, why does Allah give us all this wealth? Actually, it is the same surah. فَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ فَمَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَزِينَتُهَا. Allah says, whatever you've been given in this life, it is things to use in this life, and they are its beauty also, its beauty as well. Meaning the things Allah gives us in this world, nice clothes, nice food, nice house, nice car, these things are also from Allah. This is also part of what Allah has offered you here, but you should use these things for a higher purpose. All of this is nice, but this is all temporary, and this is not your goal in life. Really, practically speaking, at the end of the day, between a believer and a disbeliever, they could have the same job, they could have the same amount of money, they could have the same nice car, but you know, one of them has the right attitude and the other doesn't have the right attitude. And the right attitude is, this is not my goal. My goal is something much more. This is just a means to an end. وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. What Allah has is better and it lasts longer. So now, every time I think about anything in dunya, when I think about house, car, money, whatever I think of, I have to compare what Allah has given me here to what Allah will give me in the akhirah, and two comparisons always come in my mind, khayrun wa abqa. Whatever Allah has is better, whatever Allah has lasts longer. Whatever Allah has is better, meaning if I have food here, Allah will give me better food in Jannah. This is awesome food, don't get me wrong, I'm grateful for this food, but Allah has better in store. Then Allah has given me health, but this health will not last forever. This youth will not last forever. This ability even to speak for some people won't last forever. The vision you have right now, your eyesight is pretty decent. But as you get older, it's gonna get weaker. It's not going to last forever. But what Allah has for you in storage, in Jannah, that lasts longer than this. So why work so hard for something temporary when you can work hard for something permanent? That's the attitude, which is why his community says, and this is the second part of the khutbah, this next bit of advice. First of all, don't be deluded by wealth. Don't be overly happy and overly excited by material things. Think higher than that. You know, set your aim higher than that. And how do you do that? وَابْتَغِي فِيمَا أَتَاكَ اللَّهِ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ. You see, his community is not telling him to go bankrupt or give up all of his wealth, and it's haram for him to be wealthy, even though the way he made his money, that can be questioned. What they're telling him is, through whatever Allah has given you, because Allah has given this wealth to you, you should use whatever Allah has given you to pursue the next home, the final home. You have a home here, you have wealth here, but everything you've been given, you can put it to use to build your akhirah. What we're learning here in the word ma, وَابْتَغِي فِي مَا أَتَاكَ اللَّهِ, as opposed to saying فِي الَّذِي أَتَاكَ اللَّهِ, the word ma has ibham. What they say is ambiguity and tawassu', and it's open. What that suggests is whatever Allah has given you, for some of you, Allah has given high intelligence. For some of you, you're amazing programmers. For some of you, Allah has given you very good business sense. For some of you, Allah has given great physical ability. Allah has given you different things. Whatever Allah has given you, first you do an audit of what Allah has given you. Then you figure out, how do I give this to Allah? How do I use what I have to build my akhirah? How do I use this talent that I have to do something good that can build my akhirah? In other words, you're not just thinking of your talents for how to make money for yourself, how to benefit yourself. You're constantly thinking about what abilities Allah has given you and how those abilities can be used to do something good for someone else. You know, for Allah's deen, for another human being, for your neighbor, for somebody else. And when you start thinking like this, you're building the akhirah. When you're only thinking about yourself, when you're only thinking, man, this is what they program us to do, by the way, in modern education. Why do you go to school? Because you're going to get a job. So which major are you going to do? The major that's going to get you, first of all, you have a good talent in that major, and two, you can find a good job in that major. Why do you want a good job in that major? So you can make more money. At the end of the day, everything is about you. That's why you're pursuing this job. That's why you're pursuing this career. It's not about what you can do for others. Allah is saying the rizq for you will come, and more of it will come if your concern is not yourself, your concern is actually others. You want to do something more, greater than yourself. This attitude of, you know, this is against selfishness itself. Allah is not against having wealth. But Allah is, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this ayah, remarkably against wealth that is just about you. Your entire goals and aspirations are limited to yourself. How selfish and pathetic a way to live. You cannot call yourself a member of a community if you don't care about anybody beyond yourself, practically. You know, in your head you care, that doesn't mean anything. But what have you actually done? What have I actually done? This is وَابْتَغِي فِيمَا أَتَاكَ اللَّهِ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ. But then there's an extreme. The extreme is you're so concerned about everyone else, you forget about yourself. You're so busy doing things for the community, for others, for the Muslims, in the work of da'wah, in the work of charity, in the work of relief, you know, in the work of whatever else, running the school, Sunday school, volunteering in every single program, etc., etc., and you forget about your own life. You're not taking care of your own health, you're not taking care of your family, the wife never sees you, the kids never see you, you know, your job, you're failing at your job, the business is falling apart, everything's crashing down because you're saying, no, I just care about deen. Look at the balance in the Quran. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Don't forget your portion in dunya. In this worldly life, you also have a portion. The portion could be two things. It could be the things you should enjoy in life. You have, إِنَّ لِنَفْسِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا. You have rights over yourself too. You have, yourself has rights over you. You should take care of your physical body. You should eat right. You should sleep at the right time. You should spend time with your children. You should enjoy yourself in life. That's all fine. There's nothing wrong with that. On the other side, nasib also includes responsibilities. So on the one hand, things you can enjoy, but also responsibilities. In other words, you get so concerned about changing the world, but you're not taking care of your own personal responsibilities. You have responsibilities that you and I have to take care of. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Now, if you can balance all of these things, meaning on the one hand, you are pursuing the afterlife, الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ, by thinking beyond yourself. At the same time, you're not forgetting about yourself. You're also taking care of your personal, your family responsibilities, etc. And your physical responsibility, for our physical rights also. Now, above and beyond that, what is the road open for? وَأَحْسِن كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. It's remarkable. Allah says, and excel the way Allah excelled towards you. You know, another rough translation is, do good, or do beautiful work, as Allah beautified, or did such a beautiful job towards you. In other words, the way Allah made you is ihsan from Allah. أحسن الله إليك. Could be Allah has done good to you, or the way Allah has made you, like He says, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. We created the human being in the best possible way. Allah Azza wa Jal, or best possible form, Allah Azza wa Jal is informing us in this ayah that the way you've been made, the aptitude, the skill set that you have, the talent that you have, the opportunity that you have, the job that you have, all of it is actually a gift from Allah, and Allah wants to see how you can use what you have been given. Because every one of us has been given something very individual, very unique. How do you turn that into excellence? How do you respond to Allah's favor to you by going and doing excellent towards others? Allah did excellent towards you. How do you turn that and do excellent towards others? وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Ihsan first and foremost is to Allah. But once ihsan is to Allah, it becomes to everything else. You know? Everything else we do has ihsan in it. When you drive the best possible way. When you study hard. When you play hard. Everything you do, you try to do the best you possibly can. وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Now this, up until now, when we try to do the best we can in everything in life, really it puts us in a position, it's a difficult position. Because then what Allah is asking from us is balance. Allah is asking us to balance a lot of things. Allah, we want to balance our motivations of the Akhirah, but we cannot go so extreme in our motivations of the Akhirah that we forget about our dunya. And on the other hand, even when we do consider our dunya, we have to excel in everything we do, which means we cannot leave anything behind. Nothing should get shortchanged, you see? I'll give you a simple example so you understand this point. Some people are so busy at their job, and they're very good at their job. They're very, very good at their job. But at the same time, the family suffers, because they're doing so much overtime. They have no time for their kids, no time for the wife, no time for anything else. So now family is suffering. So they have ihsan at the work, but no ihsan at home. Some people are very, like, really excellent when it comes to their physical care. They do a lot of exercise, they work out, they eat right, and all of this. But when it comes to actually learning something, you know, expanding their mind, it's not there. You know, there's no time to learn for yourself. In other words, there are different aspects of our life. We have to find a way in excelling in all of them, to the best of our ability. When we try to do this, then we are trying to become a balanced human being. And by extension, the problem of the world today is that we are an imbalanced world. The societies of the world today are imbalanced. Either there are societies that are overly materialistic, or there are societies that are overly corrupt, or there are societies that are overly angry, or overly passive. This is the problem of the world today, is this imbalance. They call it extremism in one form or the other. But there's a kind of extremism inside each and every human being. They can lean one way or the other or the other. And when that happens, then fasad, corruption happens. Because when you don't take care of something, then it goes bad. It goes bad. And when you pay too much emphasis on something, that's also, you know, like لَا تَغْلُوا فِي دِينِكُمْ. You're doing too much to something, you can create corruption in that too, because you can become obsessive about something. So the final advice from his community is وَلَا تَبْغِي الْفَسَادَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Don't pursue corruption in the land. There's a remarkable insight from some mufassirun on وَلَا تَبْغِي الْفَسَادَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Before this khutbah is done, I want to share that with you as well. You know, when people, Allah has given certain people wealth and status and prominence in a community, when Allah gives them that, then they have to become models of balance. They have to be models. Everybody else looks towards them and they want to emulate them. That's just a social reality. Look at the world we live in today. Forget Islam for a second. Look at this reality we live in today. When you have singers, songwriters, actors, musicians, or entrepreneurs, business people that are millionaires, billionaires, they're on television, they're on news channels, etc. Countless people want to be like them. Countless people wish they lived in a house like they have, or they had the life that they have. Man, I want to live the life. When they say that, they're actually looking at people that are in a prominent position, and they're wishing that they were in that position, right? So when those people are imbalanced, then what happens? Then millions of people are vying and they're hoping that they can be imbalanced just like them. So they're not just corrupt themselves, they are now the source of corruption, because now they are role models to others. And they are corrupt role models to others. So when you and I have been given any position of responsibility and we don't live up to the best we can possibly do, then we become a source of corruption ourselves. Even if you're not hurting anyone else, just the fact that people are looking up to you. In your family, there are people who look up to you. If you're the oldest brother in your family, or you're the elder in your family, there are people who look up to you. If you're a member of Shura at a masjid, people look up to you. If you're the imam, people look up to you.
If you're a khatib, people look up to you. So if you don't have, if you're not trying to, you know, to live up to a balance, then you're going to cause corruption without even realizing it. Because people will use you as an example and do the wrong thing. People will use you as an example. You know, people do that. People don't look at Islam as the standard. People look at who they see as a standard. Well, he did it, I can do it. You know? How many people rely on, well, you know, why you pray so quickly? Well, I saw the imam praying quickly one time, so I think it's okay. Instead of looking up how you're supposed to pray, for most people, what do they look at? The role model. Who's in front of them, practically. That's what they shouldn't do that, but that's a reality. That's what they do. And Allah is acknowledging that social reality and letting, through this, his community, letting him know, look, if you're the most prominent member of our community, everybody knows Qarun, if you're not balanced, every one of us is going to want to be like you. Which is why it makes total sense when you go later on in this surah, and I'm done now, but later on in this surah, يَا لَيْتَ لَنَا مِثْلَ مَا أُوتِيَ قَارُونَ. Oh, if only we had what Qarun has. We wish we had what Qarun has. Most people were actually obsessed with him. They wish they lived that lifestyle. They were hoping for that. Why? Because he's in that position. It's an attractive position to be in. Everybody wants to be like that. So those of us, and by the way, in some sense, every one of us is in a position of prominence, in a position of responsibility. Many of you, are fathers in your home. You as a father in your home, the way you carry your life, the way you live your day, it sends a huge message to your children and what is important, what isn't important. You know? Without you saying a word, you are teaching them. You are teaching them. And thereby, if you don't live up to that balance and that striving for excellence, if you don't do that, then you are actually pursuing fasad in the land. وَلَا تَبْغِ الْفَسَادَ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. You see, Allah did not say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْفَاسِدِينَ. He says, الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Fasid is lazim. Mufsid is mutaaddi. Fasid means someone who is corrupt in and of themselves. Mufsid is someone who causes corruption, who spreads corruption. Allah is telling this guy, you know, through this community advice, Allah is telling Qarun, if you don't become a good example yourself, you don't straighten out your life yourself, you are not just corrupt yourself, you are the cause of corruption. You are the cause of corruption. That's heavy. That's really heavy. Now our actions are not limited to ourselves. Our misbehavior is not limited to ourselves. Even the younger kids that are here, you are an older sibling. When you have an anger problem or you talk back to your parents, or you disobey, or you lie, then you are setting an example for your younger siblings. That's what you're doing. Because your younger siblings are looking up to you. So when you do that, then it's going to spread. And that's what ifsad is, spreading corruption. So I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal, first of all, does not make us obsessed with wealth and material things, that the only thing that brings us happiness is the next material gain. That Allah gets out of our mind the obsession for the next house, or the nicer apartment, or the newer furniture, or the nicer car, or the newer phone. Get this stuff. This stuff will come and go, man. It's okay. Allah has provided a roof over your head. It's okay. You can get nice things, but don't be obsessed with them. Have them in your hand. Don't have them in your heart. You know? That's fine. But and may Allah Azza wa Jal put in our minds constantly, the thing we think about that makes us happy is how much closer we are getting to Allah, how much Quran we're memorizing, how much of the book of Allah are we understanding, how much of the seerah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are we understanding, how much of the sunan are we beautifying in our life, you know? These things should make us happy. How well are we doing, how good of a job are we doing raising our kids? The last thing I want to leave you with, I know I said last thing three times now, but 2:15 is the time I was given, so I'll stick it out. Inshallah. The last thing I share with you is, you know, because I talked a lot about balance today. Just think about this. And please think about this this weekend in particular. Balance is not something you will achieve by next Ramadan. Balance is actually about how you are going to spend the rest of today. One day. If you can make one day balanced, then you can balance out your whole life. What is the goal of one day? Like our entire life, by the way, when people are raised on Judgment Day, you know what they say? إِلَّا بِثْنَا إِلَّا يَوْمًا. We only lived one day. In other words, Allah gives a comparison that our entire life can be reduced to one day. One day. So if you can fix one day, meaning what should you accomplish in one day? For the men here, did I pray in the masjid? Did I pray Fajr in the masjid? Did I come to Aisha at the masjid? That's the beginning and end of my day was for Allah. Okay, at the very least. One day of balance. And did I spend enough time with my kids today? Did I do a good job at my work today? Did I recite Quran today? Did I eat right today? Did I exercise today? a good balanced day. Like, let's try tomorrow, or even the rest of today, let's see if we can have a balanced day. What are the things you would like to accomplish in a day that you can look back and say, you know what, today was a good day. Today was a balanced day. And you know, most of us, we look back at the day and say, man, I didn't get to do this, I didn't get to do this, I didn't get to do this. You can't finish everything, but there are some manageable responsibilities. If you can touch all of them in a day and make a habit out of that, inshallah ta'ala, through that we will achieve a balanced lifestyle. And that's really one of the calls of Allah's beautiful book. May Allah Azza wa Jal grant us a balanced lifestyle and help us all achieve ihsan in everything that we do. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayat wa dhikri al-Hakim. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.
الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح. قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله.
الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين.
الله أحد، الله الصمد، لم يلد ولم يولد، ولم يكن له كفوا أحد.
الله أكبر.
سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.